ஸ்க்ரீன் தெரியுது மேடம்.
எஸ் சார், ஸ்க்ரீன் விசிபிள் சார்.
ஓகே ஓகே, தேங்க் யூ.
தெரியுது சார். ஓகே
ஓகே,
ப்ரொசீட் சார்.
ஓகே ஓகே. ஸோ குட் ஈவினிங் எவ்ரிபடி. ஸோ டுடே வி சீ சம் வி ஸ்டார்ட் லீனியர் அல்ஜிப்ரா. இஃப் யூ லுக் அட் த சிலபஸ் ஆஃப் சிஎஸ்ஏஆர் எக்ஸாம், லீனியர் அல்ஜிப்ரா அண்ட் ரியல் அனாலிசிஸ் கேரிஸ் த மோஸ்ட் அமௌண்ட் ஆஃப் மார்க்ஸ், ரைட்? ஸோ ஃபார் எக்ஸாம்பிள், யூ கேன் எக்ஸ்பெக்ட் அட்லீஸ்ட் 35 to 45 மார்க்ஸ் ஃப்ரம் லீனியர் அல்ஜிப்ரா இட் செல்ஃப் செப்பரேட்லி. சிமிலர்லி லைக் அபவுட் 25 மார்க்ஸ் அப் டு 30 there will be real analysis problem. Already we saw real analysis, again complex analysis also, there will be lot of problems. We saw complex analysis also. Now we start linear algebra, and like I'll give couple of lectures on linear algebra, then Professor Rajesh Kannan followed by Jayaram, and like they will also cover all the important topics in linear algebra. Okay, so we try to cover all the important topics mainly through problems. Okay, so we are like, given that we have only like totally some only 6 lectures say for linear algebra, so we cannot go topic by topic. Okay, that will take lot of time. Okay, so what we do is solve as much as problem possible. What concept we need to solve the problem, that we discuss on the way. Okay, okay, so let's start. So this is our first problem. A is an n by n real matrix. Okay, so everybody know this notation, right? M and R means set of all n by n real matrices. So I consider a n by n real matrix, and I look at A delta. What is A delta? It is a matrix of cofactors. Okay, so what is matrix of cofactors? Any of you know what is a matrix of cofactors? Somebody?
Sir, ijth entry of A tilde is determinant of the matrix B obtained from A by deleting ith row and jth column.
Right, correct. So let's do one example so I mean, this is what we usually do when we find the inverse of a matrix. Okay, so let's see. First we do cofactor matrix.
Sir, of course, minus 1.
Sign is also. Yes, correct. What you're saying is correct. So let's consider this simple matrix. 1, 1, minus 1, 0, 1, 2, 1, 1, 1. Okay. So this is my A. Then what is A delta? A delta is what we want to find. So basically, A delta is also again a 3 by 3 matrix. But we're going to replace it by 2 by 2 minus. Let's see. So first, for this entry, what we do, we leave this call. You exclude the corresponding row and column. So what we get this 2 by 2 minor. So this is called minor of this entry. Okay, so we have to take the determinant. So this is 1, 2, 1, 1. Okay, but some sign is also involved. So what we do, you put a sign like this, plus, minus, plus, minus, plus, minus, plus, minus, plus. So for each entry, there is a sign is also involved. Okay, so for this entry, the corresponding sign is plus. So we just put the corresponding 2 by 2 determinant. Now for this entry, what you do, you exclude a corresponding row and column. We get 0, 1, 2, 1. So 0, 0, 1, 2, 1. So take this determinant, but the sign of this entry is minus. So you have to take minor also. Okay, so what you do, you keep filling this matrix. So now if you evaluate this determinant, it will be a number. Again, this determinant will be a number. So basically you will get 9 2 by 2 determinants. In turn, we'll get a 3 by 3 matrix. Okay, that is called cofactor matrix, because so each of them are called cofactor. So this is called the cofactor of this entry and so on. Okay, or the minor, both are same. Anyway, so for minus 1, what is the corresponding cofactor? That is 0, 1, 1, 1. The corresponding sign is plus. Here, the corresponding sign is minus. So here we get 1 minus 1, 1, 1. Here we get 1 minus 1, 1, 1. Here we get 1, 1, 1, 1. Correct? So minus. Here we get plus minus plus, 1 minus 1, 1, 2. Here we get plus minus plus. One minus one, one, one. So, sorry, which one?
Second one, sir. A12. Oh. It will be 0 to 1.
Right, right, right. One minus. Okay, sir. I don't know what I meant. Yeah, sorry. So, 1 minus 1, 1, 1. Is it correct now? With a minus. This is correct, right? Hello? Oh, sorry, sorry, sir.
Zero to 1, 1.
Yeah. Sorry. Same mistake. So, yeah, we have to leave this, right? I mean, for this entry, this is the remain. What remains is the cofactor, right? 0 yes. to 1, 1, right? Yeah. Sorry. So, remaining things are fine, right? 1,
yes.
Okay, 1 minus 1, 0. 2 plus minus, sorry, minus plus minus plus minus. And this one is 1 1 0. Okay. Anyway, so we don't need what is the actual value of this matrix. So the idea is for each matrix, there is some sign is also involved, and we have to look at the corresponding minor. That minor is obtained by excluding the rows and columns in which the matrix entry is present. Okay. Yeah, so I think now everybody can write the cofactor matrix, right? Anybody has any doubt in writing the cofactor matrix?
No,
okay.
Sir.
So if you have, okay, good. So if you have some doubt, please stop me at any time. Anyway, so this is how we write the cofactor matrix. Okay, so given n by n matrix, we can write the cofactor matrix. Okay, now it's a 3 by 3, so all the cofactor matrices are of size 2 by 2. Okay, because we are one row and one column, so remaining is 2 by 2. If it is a general n by n matrix, if you exclude one row and one column, remain n minus 1 cross n minus 1 matrix. Okay, so in case of arbitrary n by n matrices, all these cofactors are determinants of order n by n minus 1 cross n minus 1. Okay, so that is our one observation. Now given a n by n matrix, we form the A delta matrix of cofactors. So again, this is just a matter of sometimes it's called cofactor matrix. Anybody know any other name in linear algebra? There is one more name for this matrix, A delta. Like matrix of cofactors, there is another name also. Let's see whether I can remember the name before solving this problem. Yeah. So adjoint of A, we have to take transpose of this matrix. So if you remember, when we calculate the inverse of a matrix, what we do, we calculate this matrix. This is the adjoint, right? Correct. Yeah, that is what I was wondering. So we calculate adjoint, then is it, what is the identity? A times adj a equal to determinant of A times identity, right? Yeah, so this is not adjoint. If you calculate the transpose, that is the adjoint. Correct? So we call the inverse of a matrix. What we do, we form all these cofactors, then we evaluate this 2 by 2 minus, then we take the transpose. Right, the transpose is, so for A, for this matrix, you can suppose we get adjoint. Okay. So far, fine. So this is not adjoint. We have to take the transpose to get the adjoint. Anyway. Yeah, right, fine. So the question is, what is the rank of A delta? Okay, so suppose rank of A, if rank of A is N, what is rank of A delta? If rank of A is n minus 1, what is rank of A delta? If rank of A is less than or equal to n minus 2, what is rank of A to eta? So anybody has seen this problem already? Any idea about this problem? Any guesses what could be the answer? Okay, so maybe I'll tell the answer. So let's see, what is the rank of rank of A is n. Okay, so we assume rank of A equal, so first option, so rank of A, we assume it is n. Okay, now A is a n by n real matrix and rank of A is n. From this, can we conclude that determinant of A is not equal to 0?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
So somebody can say how?
Rank of,
if rank of A is equal to 0.
Due to linear independence of the columns. So that's why we cannot write it in there. Zero cannot be written. Linear combinations of that rank. In columns.
Okay. So yeah, okay. So that is yeah, that is one definitely a valid argument. Okay, so what we do, maybe
so rank of A equal to n means it has n linearly independent vectors.
No, linearly independent columns.
Columns.
That's what you meant, right? Yeah. So from that, how do you conclude determinant of A is not equal to 0? Yeah, it has n linearly independent columns. Fine. From that, how do you conclude determinant of A is not equal to 0?
Sir, rank of A equal to A means?
You are asking what is the meaning of
inverse
rank of A
exist. Inverse of A exist.
Yeah, but why?
So determinant of A not equal to 0.
Okay, so if rank of A equal to N, then why A inverse exists?
Sir, A is, Mn R is isomorphic to collection of linear transformation.
Right, R n to R n.
If rank of A equal to n, then corresponding their linear transformation is also n. So T is 1-1 and onto.
T is onto, because rank of A equal to n means that T is onto. Because yeah, I will write the online proof. Finite. Why rank of? Huh?
Since it is a finite, we can say T is onto and also, sir. So therefore, T is non-singular. Kernel T equals singular.
Okay. So if it is a finite dimensional, why it is on? So if somebody is not following, don't worry, I'm going to give the complete details just want to discuss a little bit, nothing much. Okay, so like what you're saying is correct, that is like linear algebra, now we know many results, right? So we can use all possible results to get the required answer. Anyway, so but yeah, you guys, what you said, it was correct. So so A is a n by n matrix, right? So it can be thought of as a linear transformation from R power n to R power n. Suppose if you take a matrix, A belongs to, maybe I write, if A is a m by n matrix. If A is a m by n matrix, then A is a linear transformation from R power n to R power n. Okay. So this is one thing to remember. So if it is a M matrix, it's not a linear transformation from R power M to R power N. It is actually R power N to R power F. That one thing we have to remember. But anyway, this is a N by N matrix. Don't worry anything. So it is R power N to R power N. Now rank of A equal to N means that, now let's write the definition of rank. There are many various definitions of rank. This is the first definition of rank we're going to see today. Like, we'll see for the next problem, we need another definition of rank. So we'll see many different definitions of rank. So rank of A is dimension of range of A. Okay. Now, range of A is a subspace of the codomain. Codomain is Rn. Now, what we know, rank of A equal to n. That is what we know. Okay. Rank of A equal to n implies range. Range is always a, sorry. So if I make some typos, please correct me. Okay, that is range of A is fine. Yeah. So range of A is a subspace. So whenever you have a linear transformation, its image, it is always a subspace. So and its dimension is the rank. Rank of A equal to n means that range of A is a subspace of dimension n in R power n. Okay, in the R power n, range is a subspace of dimension n. Okay, so this implies that in a n dimensional vector space, if you have a n dimensional subspace, that means that the vector space, it should be vector space should be the whole space. So it means that range of A equal to Rn. Okay, so this Rn is the codomain. So whenever range equal to codomain, this means that A is onto. Okay, so onto means that every element in the codomain has pre-image. If codomain is equal to range, every element in the range always have pre-image by definition. That is the definition of range. Okay, so from this we can conclude that A is onto. So what we have concluded now is if A is a n by n matrix whose rank is n, then it is onto. Now next, this is a very very simple but very important result. Okay, so result, so again we take A belongs to mn of R, but again mn of R, mn of C, doesn't matter, over any field this result will work. So we just need a square matrix. So then A is onto if and only if A is 1 1. Okay, so proof we need a rank nullity theorem. Anybody know proof without using rank nullity theorem? Actually, rank nullity theorem says this statement only. Whatever I have written, like this is what rank nullity theorem. But anyway, so what is rank nullity theorem? If T is a linear transformation from V to W, V and W are finite dimensional vector spaces. If dimension of V is equal to n, okay, then n is equal to the dimension of the domain equal to dimension of kernel of T plus dimension of range of T. Okay, now dimension of kernel of T is what we call nullity. Okay, yeah, plus dimension of range is what we saw, it is a rank of T. Okay, so the dimension of the domain, the dimension of the codomain doesn't matter. So dimension of the domain, this n is equal to nullity of T plus rank T. Okay, so we will use rank nullity theorem again and again, so you can understand when we use it, it will make better sense to you. Anyway, so now we have A is a linear transformation from Rn to Rn, correct? Therefore, and we have rank of A is also n. Rank of A is also n. Now, n equal to, so we use the rank nullity theorem, sir. Okay. So dimension of the domain, that is n. N equal to nullity of T or nullity of A. Nullity of A plus rank of A. Rank of A is n. Correct. In our problem, rank of A is n. This implies nullity of A is equal to 0. This implies dimension of kernel of A equal to 0. This implies kernel of A equal to singleton 0. So dimension 0 means that the vector space has to be just a singleton 0. Okay. Now, let's prove this result. T is 1 1 if happen only if kernel of t equal to singleton 0. So now proof t is 1 1. T is 1 1 if and only if tx equal to ty implies x equal to 1. Okay, so this is the definition of 1 1. So what is the definition of 1 1? Distinct elements mapped to distinct images. Okay, so for example, if you look at what is a good simple example of 1 1 function, like maybe f of x equal to e power x. Is there any simple other 1 1 functions?
You can take identity function.
Yeah, identity is so too trivial. Anyway, maybe you can take f of x equal to x as he is suggesting. Then, like, if you take two unequal number, then its image is also unequal, right? So 1 1 means that x not equal to y implies f of x not equal to f of y. Okay. For example, if you look at f of x equal to e power x, okay, then if x not equal to y, then you will always have e power x not equal to e power y. Therefore, this f of x equal to e power x log x, then what are some other 1 1 functions? Yeah, there are many many functions like f of
x power n or
x cube, you're saying. X cube kind of functions. So there are many 1 1 functions. So to prove some function is 1 1, we have to verify that if x not equal to y, then f of x not equal to f of y. That means that whenever elements are distinct, their images has to be distinct. That is what 1 1 function means. Conversely, so instead of proving this, what we can prove, suppose two elements has equal images, then we prove that the elements has to be same. So to prove this condition, we can equally prove this condition. Okay, so sometimes this condition will be useful, sometimes this condition will be useful. Okay, so it depends on the context and depends on the function. Anyway, so we're going to use this condition. So t is 1 1 if and only if t of x equal to t of y implies x equal to y. So if and only if t of x minus t of y equal to 0 implies x minus y equal to 0. If and only if t of x minus y equal to 0 implies x minus y equal to 0. If and only if x, so x and y, like if we can just substitute x minus y equal to z. So t of z equal to 0 implies z equal to 0. So whenever t takes some value to 0, then that value has to be 0. That means that z belongs to kernel of t implies z equal to 0. If and only if. So if z belongs to kernel of t, means that z equal to 0. What does that mean? It means that 0 is the only element belongs to kernel. Okay. So what we have concluded is, again, you can, so we can go reverse direction also. Okay. So what we have proved is t is 1 1 if and only if kernel of t equal to singleton 0. Okay. So now here what we have proved is that if rank of A equal to N, then we have proved that kernel of A equal to singleton 0. Okay. So let's try to understand what is happening here. We assumed rank is N. Then we got kernel of A equal to singleton 0 by rank nullity theorem. Now if kernel of A equal to singleton 0, then the A should be 1 1. Okay. So already we proved that it is onto, right? Because if rank of A equal to N, then A is onto. Okay, so I'll share the notes. You try to follow the flow, it will be fine. Okay, so what we conclude is, so if it's a linear transformation, or if it is a N by N matrix, then it is onto if and only if 1 1. Okay, so that's a proof we just saw. Now using this result, we want to understand the rank of A. If rank of A equal to n, then we want to understand what is rank of A delta, the matrix of cofactors. So let's move on to that problem. So rank of A equal to n. So we want rank of A delta. What is rank of A delta? That is the question. Now rank of A equal to n implies A is 1-1 and onto. That is what we just saw. Okay, so this implies A is invertible. Bijection means invertible. This implies determinant of A is not equal to 0. So this is the claim I was asking you. If rank of A equal to n, then determinant of A is not equal to 0. So now we have this simple identity. A times adga equal to adga times A equal to determinant of A times identity matrix. This is very important identity. Well, we have in our school itself, we have seen it, but it is very interesting, very important. So this identity, all of you guys might have seen already, right? So from this one, we get A inverse is equal to 1 by determinant of A times adga. Okay, because if you take A inverse to be this matrix, so basically if you bring this determinant of A to here, to the denominator, then you will get A times adga by determinant of A equal to identity matrix, right? So that means that this is the inverse of the matrix A. Okay. So A inverse equal to 1 by determinant of A at J. Even in many interviews, they will ask why A inverse equal to 1 by determinant. They will ask this question, like we say that A is invertible if determinant of A is not equal to 0. Why? Right. So because to define inverse, you need the determinant of A should come in the denominator. But you can put something in the denominator if it is not equal to 0. Okay. So in order to make sense this determinant of A in the denominator, we assume that we need determinant of A to be non-zero in order to A inverse to be exist. Okay. Now, so we have this identity. And what is adga? Adga is equal to A delta transpose. Okay. So by definition, adjoint of A is nothing but our matrix of cofactors. For that matrix, you have to take transpose. Okay. Now, A inverse equal to 1 by determinant of A times adga. Okay. Similarly, adga inverse. So you calculate the inverse of the matrix adga using this expression. Using this expression, what it will be? It will be equal to 1 by determinant of A times A. Is it correct? Because we have A times because we have A times adga equal to determinant of A times I. So from this, we conclude that adga times 1 by determinant of A times A, this is equal to identity. So if you multiply this matrix with adga, we are getting identity matrix. That means that this matrix is the inverse of adga. Okay, so inverse of adga exists if A is invertible. Okay, again, if determinant of A equal to not equal to 0, then for adga also inverse exists. Okay, so adga is invertible. So if adga is invertible, it's a transpose. If you take the transpose of adga, you will get A transpose, A delta transpose, the whole transpose. That is just A delta. Okay. So this implies adga is invertible. This implies A delta, this is equal to adga transpose, is invertible. This implies rank of A delta is equal to n. If a matrix is invertible, if the matrix has determinant not equal to 0, then its rank is n. Okay, so that we saw in the beginning itself. Rank of A equal to n if and only if determinant of A is not equal to n. Where we saw that is again follows from okay. So if rank of A equal to but I think we have so everything is written here. So please check what's going on here. So we get rank of A delta is equal to n. So if rank of A is n, in this case rank of A delta is equal to n. So is it clear or any doubt in the first option? Is it fine?
Hello.
Yes, sir. It's clear.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So if you have some doubts, please stop me. So we go to the option 3 and we come back to option 2. Okay. So anybody has some idea about option 3? Option C. If rank of A is less than or equal to n minus 2, what is rank of A delta? Okay, so I'll explain. Okay, so for that we need another definition of rank. Okay, so maybe with that definition it is immediate the answer to the question C. So the option is rank of A is less than or equal to n minus 2. That is what is given. Now definition of rank. Rank of A is equal to highest order non-vanishing minor. So this is a very, very important definition of rank. Using this definition, it is easy to calculate the rank of a matrix usually. Okay. What is the definition? Highest order non-vanishing minor. Okay. Suppose I have some 10 by 10 matrix. Okay. And I want to find the rank of this 10 by 10 matrix. First, what I'll do, I'll look at the 10 by 10 minors of this matrix. Okay, so for this, if it's a 10 by 10 matrix, it will have only one 10 by 10 minor, that matrix itself. So if that determinant is not equal to 0, then the rank is 10. So because the highest order non-vanishing minor is 10. Okay, so maybe let's look at some simple example. One one minus one zero zero two four one 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 zero 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 one one. Let's look at this matrix. So this is a 4x4 matrix. What are minors? Minors means some submatrix, square submatrix. Okay, for this is a 2x2 minor. This is a 3x3 minor. This is a 4x4 minor. Okay. So for a 4x4 matrix, there can be minors of order 1, 2, 3, 4. So each entry is a 1x1 minor. Okay. Now we are interested in highest order non-vanishing minor. Okay. So highest order. So maximum is 4. So if the full minor is that full determinant is non-zero, then that should be the maximum. There cannot be anything higher than 4. Right. So if the full determinant is not equal to 0, then rank is equal to 4. Okay, suppose full determinant is 0. Okay, if full determinant is 0, then definitely 4 is not the highest order non-vanishing minor. So we have to come to 3. So we look at 3x3 minors. Okay, so there are many 3x3 minors. So you check, is there at least one 3x3 non-vanishing minor? So for example, determinant of this 3x3 or determinant of this 3x3. Or determinant of this 3x3 and so on. Okay. So if one of that 3x3 minor means determinant. Okay. If one of that 3x3 determinant is non-zero, then rank is 3. Suppose all the 3x3 sub minors are 0, then we come to 2x2 minors. Okay. If any of the 2x2 minors are 0, then rank is 2. If all the 2 by 2 minors are 0, then we look at 1 by 1 minors. If any of the 1 by 1 minor, so 1 by 1 minor is just the number itself. If any of the 1 by 1 minor is non-zero, then the rank is 1. If all the minors are vanishes, that means that the matrix is a 0 matrix and rank is 0. Okay. So, is it clear that this definition of rank? Maybe we'll do an example. Like 1, 2, 3, 0, 1, 1, 2, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. So, what is the rank of this matrix? Should I adjust some indices? Yeah, so maybe a little bit I'll adjust. 1, 2, 4, 2. Just to make it, to understand the definition term. So, what is the rank of this matrix?
2, sir.
Yeah. One, so, sir. It is 2. 2, right? It is 2 because at least this 2 by 2 minor is non-zero, right?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Right. Yeah. So, this 2 by, at least rank is at least 2. Because if you calculate the determinant of this 2 by 2 block, then the determinant is non-zero, therefore rank is at least 2, but here the largest possible minor is 3 by 3, okay? So we know that if A is a m by n matrix, okay, then rank of A is less than or equal to minimum of m comma n. So many of you guys might seen this result. This is because anybody know why this is the reason? Why if it is a square matrix, then rank of A less than or equal to minimum of M comma N?
Because the column rank equals to the row rank, and for rank is a dimension.
That is true, but in terms of linear transformation, can you say something? If you think of A as a linear transformation, if it is a matrix, M by N matrix, then it is going from
Rn to Rm.
Yeah, it is a linear transformation from Rn to Rm. Okay. Now, what is rank? Rank is the, like, so you look at the image. Suppose say, A is the linear transformation, go from here to here, and this is image of A. Okay, and this is my r power m, and say this is my r power n. Okay, so then, so definitely, we are claiming that rank of A is less than or equal to minimum of m comma n. So that means that rank of A less than or equal to m as well as less than or equal to n. So if it is less than or equal to both of these numbers, then it is less than or equal to minimum also. So less than or equal to minimum means that less than both the numbers. That's what it means. So clearly rank is less than or equal to M. Correct? Because the image is a subset of the codomain. The full space itself has dimension M. So this subspace also can have dimension at most M. Therefore, but rank is the dimension of the image. Therefore, it cannot cannot be more than n. So rank is less than or equal to m. Similarly, why rank is less than or equal to n?
Rank null theorem.
Yeah, it's correct. So again, so now this A is a linear transformation from r power n to r power m by rank nullity theorem n equal to nullity okay maybe I write it in terms of kernel equal to dimension of kernel of a plus dimension of range of a okay now this is n so we want to know so we claim that rank of a is less than or equal to n already we saw that rank of a less than or equal to m we claim that rank of a is less than or equal to n now if you note so we want this quantity is less than or equal to n okay now this is a non negative number okay I mean this number can be either 0 1 2 and so on like a non negative integer okay so this is a non negative integer because if it is a dimension means it should be 0 1 2 and so on similarly this number also 0 1 2 and so on if you sum these two numbers you are getting n that means that this number can be maximum n because if this is n plus 1 then the total cannot be n because this is not going to be negative right so from this equality we get rank is at most n okay so whenever you have a linear transformation from r power n to r power m then its rank is less than or equal to n as well as less than or equal to m so if it is less than both the things then it is definitely less than or equal to minimum also so you take the minimum it will definitely less than the minimum also so this is a now this is a 3 by 4 matrix okay therefore its rank can be maximum 3 because rank is less than or equal to minimum of 3 comma 4 minimum of 3 comma 4 is 3 so rank is less than or equal to 3 okay so this will have rank at most 3 anyway another way of seeing is like here you can form only 3 by 3 minors so rank is a highest order non vanishing minor right minor means it is a square matrix therefore rank can be maximum 3 so here if you calculate so you can calculate all the 3 by 3 minors how many 3 by 3 minors are there here for this matrix how many 3 by 3 minors are here 4 no
four.
you just throw away one column
yes sir
what remains is a 3 by 3 minor you remove this will be a 3 by 3 minor okay now this has determinant 0 because these two rows are scalar multiple of each other right 1 2 1 and 2 4 2 so similarly if you throw away this column so what remains is a 3 by 3 minor there also these two rows are linearly dependent so similarly you can throw this column you will get a 3 by 3 minor similarly you get a 3 by 3 minor so in all these four 3 by 3 minors determinant is 0 therefore rank cannot be 3 so then we have to look at a 2 by 2 minors so this 2 by 2 minor has determinant 3 which is not equal to 0 therefore highest order non vanishing minor is 2 okay therefore rank is 2 for this matrix but that can be seen directly because if you multiply this row by 2 you will get this row therefore these two rows are linearly linearly dependent so you throw away if two rows are linearly dependent you throw away that okay so you throw away you left with only these two rows but so these two rows are linearly independent okay so you see here you have 0 here you have 1 so from that itself you can conclude that these two are linearly independent or you can look at the again 2 by 2 minor this is non zero so they are linearly independent vectors okay so rank is 2 for this vector okay now we know what is rank means highest order non vanishing minor right so now let's come to this problem rank of a is less than or equal to n minus 2 then what is rank of a tilde matrix of cofactors Somebody? If it is confusing, you assume rank is equal to n minus 2. No problem. If rank equal to n minus 2, what is rank of A tilde? It is very simple, no?
It should be
Sorry, what?
It should also be less than n minus 2 because, if we get rank is less than n minus 2, that means we have a minor, maximum minor of non-zero minor that can have. It's 0 to n minus 1, right?
Right.
N minus 2. So, if we get... No, that cannot be confused. That will imply the rank of A.
0.
Yeah, why 0?
Because all n minus 2 determinants will be 0.
Yes. 0, correct. So actually, in this case, the matrix A delta itself is a 0 matrix. Because what we just saw, if rank of A is at most n minus 2, that means that the highest order non-vanishing minor is can be maximum n minus 2. That means that all the n minus 1 minors are 0. Okay. So that is why this highest is very important. Okay. So rank is not equal to n. Therefore, full determinant is 0. That is fine. But if rank is also not equal to n minus 1, because rank is less than or equal to n minus 2. Since rank is not equal to n minus 2, all the n minus 1 order minus all the n minus 1 order minors are 0. Because if there is one non-vanishing minor of order n minus 1, then rank is at least n minus 1. Okay. So whenever you have a minor of order k, non-zero minor of order k, then rank of A is at least k. Okay. So that is what very important. So all the n minus 1 order minors are 0, but in A delta, how we are forming A delta? By replacing each entry by n minus 2 minors. Right? Sorry, n minus 1 minors. All of them are n minus 1 cross n minus 1 order minors, right? But if it has rank at most n minus 2, all these minors will vanish. So all this determinant will 0. So we get 0, 0, 0 everywhere. In particular, A delta will be 0. So we get that matrix is equal to 0 matrix. In particular, rank is 0. Okay? So rank of A delta is equal to 0 in this case. Is it clear? Option C? Or is there any doubt in option C?
No, sir. It's fine.
Okay, sir. Yeah. So you check it. Any doubt also, you just you can ask me later also. No? Anyway, so this rank of A is n minus 1. That is a little bit tricky, but not very tricky. But it is very interesting. Anyway, so option B, rank of A is n minus 1. Again, we want what is rank of A delta. Okay. Now, so this identity is always true. A times adga equal to adga times A. This is equal to determinant of A times identity. Okay. Note that this is a scalar matrix. So identity matrix, you multiply with determinant of A, what you get? It is a diagonal matrix with all the diagonal entries are equal to determinant of A. Okay. So we are getting, we have this expression. So what we want to do, we want rank of A delta. Okay. So what we do, so always rank of A equal to rank of A transpose. So anybody know why rank of A equal to rank of A transpose?
Elementary row and column operation does not change rank.
Elementary row and what? Column operation won't change rank. So elementary row and column operation won't change rank. So from that, how you are concluding rank A equal to rank A transpose?
I think your number of linearly independent column and rows are equal. So number of linearly independent row and columns are equal. If I am transpose it, whether I can get same thing.
Right. But,
yeah.
Okay, but why number of independent rows is equal to number of independent columns?
Because the row rank and the column rank of a matrix.
Rank is, means yeah. Row rank columns are equal, sir.
Why row rank is equal to column rank?
A transpose will be linear transposition between the dual spaces.
Right. Anyway, so the dual space argument is the correct argument. But anyway, in the MSc level, it's less chance for many people to see the dual space. Okay. So with dual space means a V star. Set of all linear functionals from V to the field F. Okay. So if T is a linear transformation from like say V to W, then we can define a map in the other direction. W dual space, W star to V star. Okay. So say this is linear transformation is yes. Okay. Then if you look at the, if A is a matrix of T, then for S, the corresponding matrix will be A transpose. But anyway, like whatever argument you said, they are all correct. But whatever argument you are saying, in each of that argument, you are assuming something. Okay, because like if independent rows equal to independent columns, because of that, rank of A equal to rank of A transpose, they are equal. We cannot say that because there we are assuming that number of independent rows equal to number of independent columns. That we are assuming. Okay. So without assuming anything, you try to prove this result. Okay. Rank of A equal to rank of A transpose. It will be very, very interesting. Okay. So maybe you need to use this dual space or using some result. So similarly, like what we want. We just want rank of A equal to rank transpose. Okay, this much is enough. So if rank of A equal to rank of A transpose, we have rank of, so this implies rank of A delta is equal to rank of RJ. Correct, because if you take the transpose of A delta, you will get RJ. So since RJ transpose equal to A delta, okay? So we want to find the rank of A delta. Equivalently, we can find the rank of RJ. Okay, so that is the idea by using this result. Okay, now how to find the rank of RJ? That is the question. Now, what we have assumed, rank of A is N minus 1. That is the assumption we have. We want to find the rank of RGA. We have A times RGA equal to determinant of A times identity. What is determinant of A?
Because N minus 1, 0.
Right, 0. Because determinant of A is not equal to 0 if and only if rank of A is N. Once the rank is decreased, then the rank, then the determinant will be 0. So we get A times RGA is equal to 0. Okay. If rank of, okay, A, so okay. Now A times RGA equal to 0. Now A times RGA, suppose I am acting it on a vector. Okay, so this is a matrix and this is a matrix. Both are n by n matrices. So product will be a 1 n by n matrix. On this n by n matrix, I am acting a one column vector V. Okay, so how do I do this calculation? So A at J of B, this is equal to 0 because this matrix is a 0 matrix. So this means that A of, I mean, how do we multiply? First we multiply this vector V on this matrix, then this is n by n, this is n by 1, together we get n by 1 vector. So this will give me a n by 1 vector. So on this n by 1 vector, A is a n by n matrix. So if you multiply, this n and n are same, so you can multiply, you will get a n by 1 matrix. Sorry, n by 1 vector. Okay, so finally the answer will be a vector. So A of at J of V equal, sorry, A of at J. So in at J, you multiply. So first at J acts on V, on the resulting vector A acts, and the answer is 0. So what is the meaning of that? So if you look at this vector, at J of V, this belongs to range of at J, correct? Because this is of the form A of V. So A of V means that this vector A of V will belongs to range of A, correct? So at J of V will belongs to range of at J, but A kills this vector, right? So A takes at J of V to 0. So from that we can conclude that at J, range of at J is subset of kernel of A. Is it clear? I'll just take 1 minute, 1 minute break. Please, you try to understand this. Sorry, yes. Okay. So, I mean, like A times at J, yeah, whenever like you have A, B equal to 0, that means that range of B is contained in kernel of A. Okay, so this is very important. So from that, we get range of at J contained in kernel of A. This implies rank of A is, rank of adj, correct, adjoint of A is less than or equal to nullity of A. But what is nullity of A? So if you sum nullity and rank, you should get n. Okay, so here we are assuming rank is n minus 1. By rank nullity theorem, if you sum rank and nullity you should get n. That means that nullity is 1. Okay. So now nullity is 1. This implies rank of RGA is less than or equal to 1. Okay. Since n of A equal to 1 by rank nullity theorem. N of A is equal to 1 by rank nullity theorem. So rank of RGA is less than or equal to 1. We claim that rank of RGA equal to 1. Okay. Why? Because if rank of RGA equal to 0. Okay, rank of RGA less than or equal to 1 means that rank should be either 0 or 1. This implies RGA equal to 0. I mean, what is the only matrix which has rank 0 is the 0 matrix. So we get RGA is 0 matrix, which implies that rank of A is strictly less than n minus 1. Because RGA is 0 means that all the n minus 1 minors are vanishing. Okay, because RGA consists of n minus 1 minus, all the n minus 1 minus, right? Therefore, RGA equal to 0 means that rank A is strictly less than n minus 1. But we are assuming that rank A is n minus 1. Okay. So this is separately. Therefore, rank of RGA equal to 1. Okay, so this is the end of it. Okay, so think about it. So the important thing is not the problem. I mean, solving this problem is not a big deal, but we are recollecting. Like, I choose this problem because in one problem we are dealing with many important linear algebra concepts. So I thought I will do this problem first. Okay. So rank A is n, rank A delta is 1, rank A delta is 0. So if when n, this is n, then when n minus 1, it is suddenly reduces to 1. And when it's less than or equal to n minus 2, it becomes 0. So that is very interesting. Yeah, so this is asked in NBHM exam many times. Also in CSIR and GATE, both the exam. So they asked like this option and this option, like two out of three options are asked repeatedly in many exams. Right? Okay. So that is why it's a very interesting problem. Anyway, so let's move on to the next problem.
Sir, before you go further, sir, you asked that can you prove that we are trying to prove determinant of A is non-zero without provoking the rank nullity theorem you were talking about? Can you tell us?
So what is the result you are saying?
Determinant of A is non-zero. We proved it using the rank nullity theorem, right?
Right. Determinant of A not equal to zero.
And A is rank n. A has rank n. Right?
If and only if rank of A equal to n. Okay. Yeah. So we want to prove it without using rank nullity theorem.
Yeah. Only the ontoness of A function. Right.
Right. Is there a simple way? Maybe. Okay, we'll discuss after 8. Okay, so immediately I can't think of anything, but it would be nice to prove by like very basic without using any research. Okay,
yes.
Yeah, we'll discuss yes. After the class.
Sure, sir. Thank you.
So let A and B the n by n matrix whose ijth entry is 2 times delta ij minus delta I plus 1 comma j minus delta I comma j plus 1, where delta ij is the Kronecker delta. Okay, if I equal to j, then 1, otherwise 0. Then what is the determinant of the matrix AN? Okay, so this is a CSIR problem only, but I didn't include the options. Okay. And so, like, the point of this problem is, many times what happens is this delta ISR looks scary. So people leave this problem without answering. It is actually they are asking what is the determinant, but it is a part C problem. So like in part C, I mean, if the answer is what is the determinant, then the answer is only one answer, right? Option can there will be only one correct answer, right? But it is a part C problem, so more than one option cannot be true in for this problem at least. But it is asked in part C because the problem is a little bit looks scary, but once you got the idea, it is very simple. Okay, so if it is a part C problem, it is 4.75, so you can definitely give it a shot. What do you do? So for each n, they are defining the matrix. So first you write the matrix in the 2x2, 3x3, then you will get the answer most of the time. Okay, so let's see how to do this problem. So we have this matrix A. So A is the matrix Aij. Okay, so Aij, the ijth entry is equal to 2 times delta ij minus delta I comma j minus delta I comma j plus 1. Delta I comma j plus 1. Okay. So this is the ijth entry. Okay, let's do 2x2 case. Okay, so maybe let's write. So what is 1-1 entry? So if it is 1-1, then I equal to 1 and j equal to 1. So what we get, so whenever you are filling a diagonal entry, these two will be same. I and j will be same in the diagonal, right? So we get it 2. So in all these matrices AN, the diagonal will be always 2. And if it is in the diagonal I equal to j. Okay, if I equal to j, then I plus 1 and j, I and j plus 1, they will never equal. So these terms will be 0. So only these terms will contribute. Note that delta ij is equal to 1 if I equal to j. And 0 otherwise. Okay, so if I is not equal to j, then this value will be 0. Okay. So from that, we can conclude that. So for diagonal, it is 2. Now, what is this entry? So this is 1 comma 2, right? A 1 comma 2. So 1 comma 2, so I equal to 1, j equal to 2. So what happens? This will be 0 now because I and j are not equal. Now this is 1, this is 2. This is I equal to 1. So I plus 1 is 2. This is 2, 2 comma 2. Both are same. So we get a minus 1. So this will be minus 1. This is 1. This is 3. So this will not contribute anything. So we get minus 1. Similarly, here also minus 1. So for n equal to 2, this is the matrix. So now we can guess. So if you look at the arbitrary I comma jth entry, if I equal to j, then this term will survive. This term will vanish. So always diagonal will be 2 because there is this 2. If I equal to j plus 1, okay, if I equal to j plus 1, for example, like I equal to, so I equal to j means 1 comma 1, 2 comma 2, that kind of entry. I equal to j plus 1 means like 2 comma 1, 3 comma 2. So in the matrix, these kind of entries will be there, right? So for that kind of entries, what happens is I equal to j plus 1. If I equal to j plus 1, that this entry will survive. These two entries will be 0. Okay. Similarly, if I plus 1 equal to j, that means that 1 comma 2, 2 comma 3, these kind of entries also If I plus 1 equal to j, means this term will survive, these terms will be 0. So what happens is, for example, let's write a 4 by 4 matrix. So 1, 1, A, 1, 2, A, 1, 3, A, 1, 4, A, 2, 1, A, 2, 2, A, 2, 2, 3, A, 2, 4, A, 3, 1, A, 3, 2, A, 3, 3, A, 3, 4, A, 4, 1, A, 4, 2, A, 4, 3. A 4 4. Okay, now in the diagonal you will have I equal to j. So diagonal will be for diagonal this will be contribute, this will be 0. So diagonal will be 2, but this I plus 1 and j should be equal. So I plus 1 and j will be equal for this diagonal. See 1 2 2 3 3 4. Similarly, I and j plus 1 will be equal here in this diagonal. Okay. So in this diagonal, 2, 1, 3, 2, 4, 3. So what they are saying is this diagonal will be 2. This both this diagonal, this is called a super diagonal. So both these diagonals are minus 1. So in general, our matrix will be of the form 2, minus 1, 0, 0, 0. So I write the 5 by 5 example, 0, 0, 0. So the matrix will be of this form, okay? Main diagonal will be 2, super diagonals will be minus 1. So the question is, what is the determinant of this matrix? Is it clear how we are forming this matrix? So just this condition you have to understand. Once you understand the condition, you got the matrix. Once you got the matrix, the answer is immediate. So far, good? Is it fine?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so how to find the determinant of this matrix? So, note that we have to find the determinant of An for the n by n case. I am asking for the 5 by 5 case only, but in the n by n case, arbitrary n by n case, diagonal will be 2, both this diagonal will be minus 1. So, for a n by n case, what is the determinant? Or at least what is the determinant in the case 5 by 5. So, so anybody have some any idea how to do it? So if you don't know any, so if nothing comes in mind, always good strategy is to find the smaller values. Okay. So for what is determinant of A2? Determinant of A2 is like 2 by 2, right? So this is the 2 by 2. So determinant will be 4 minus 1, that is 3. Is that correct? So what is determinant of A1? A1 is 2. A2 is 3. What is determinant of A3? A3 is this. Okay, so 2 into 4. Minus 1, 3, 6, so then minus 1 times, minus 1 is plus 1 times, minus 2, 4, so 4. Okay, so A1 is 2, A2 is 3, A3 is 4, then what is determinant of An?
An. N plus,
n plus 1. Okay, so actually that is the answer. Finally, the one of the option was n plus 1. So the final answer is n plus 1. Okay, so now we know the answer, but how to prove it? So you take the n by n matrix whose diagonals are 2, super diagonals are minus 1. How to prove the determinant of such a matrix is n plus 1? Yeah. So this is a one standard. Actually, this is a problem in combinatorics. Okay, so if you study some this differential equations, there is something called a difference equation or a recurrence equation. So there they solve this kind of problems like
right diagonal.
So what you do? What matrices?
Tri-diagonal matrices.
Tri-diagonal matrices, yes. So, or it is also called some doublets. You heard of such matrices? Some doublets matrices. Let's check it quickly. That's very important. Doublets.
Toplets operators. It has a matrix like that. Yeah. Toplets.
Toplets. Yeah. I saw it long back, but suddenly now it comes in. Yeah. So these are a particular case of this toplet matrices. So please check. So you see, A, B, C, D, E. So the entries are circulated, right? F, A, B, C, D, E, G. Yeah, so they are of some particular form. A naught, A minus 1, A minus 1, A1. Yeah, so any matrix of this particular form is called a doublets matrices. But this is some particular kind of a doublets matrix. So that is what I remember. Please check once what is doublets matrices. Okay. Anyway. So how to solve this problem? What we do, we just blindly calculate the determinant. Let's see how it goes. Okay. So that dn equal to determinant of this matrix. Okay. Assume this is n by n. Don't think of it as a 5 by 5. Think of it as n by n. Let's dn be the determinant of this matrix. Let's calculate dn. Dn equals, so how do we calculate the determinant? We expand through first row. So now two times this row, this column, we will get this, right? Determinant of this minor. But what is this minor? This is An minus 1. Correct? This is again the matrix of same type. So this is An minus 1. So we get two times Dn minus 1. So Dn is determinant of An. So, two times, this will be an minus 1. So, two times determinant of an minus 1, that is 2n minus 1. Now, this is minus 1. So, minus of minus. So, we have this sign, right? So, minus of minus 1, we get plus 1. And we have to look at the corresponding minor. So, we have to calculate the determinant of this matrix. Minus 1, minus 1, 0, 0, 0, 2, minus 1, 0. So what is the determinant of this minor? Minus 1 times plus
Dn minus.
So I'll just strike this through. So I'll get minus 1 times. So now I'm evaluating this 4 by 4 determinant. Okay. So I'll get minus 1 times. What is this?
Dn minus 2.
Dn minus
2. Dn minus 2. Then this minus 1, right? This minus 1 times. That is 0 because of this 0. Is that correct? For this minus 1, if you calculate the corresponding determinant, it will be 0. So we get, what we get? We get dn equal to 2 times dn minus 1 minus dn minus 2. So this is called recurrence equation. This is called recurrence equation, right? Or difference equation. So, forget the name, but anyway, so what are the initial condition? D1 equal to 2, D2 equal to 3. Okay, so if you know some elementary this recurrence equation, like solving differential equation, you can solve this kind of equation also. So finally, you will get the answer is dn equal to n plus 1. Okay, here also they will talk about this homogeneous equation, and it will have a unique solution, so things like that. But from the initial condition, actually you can guess the solution. It is 2, 3, and it satisfies this condition. Dn equal to 2 times dn minus 1 minus dn minus 2. So can we rewrite it suitably so that we can see dn is n plus 1? I don't see it immediately, but we can solve it and we find the dn is n plus 1. Yeah, so please check how to solve recurrence equations. So the answer is n plus 1. So the determinant of this matrix is n plus 1. So anybody know how to solve this recurrence equation? So there will be some substitution, like in the differential equation, we find this complementary function, particular solution.
Here we write the characteristic equation of that solution. R² - 2R + 1 equal to 0.
Oh, just a minute, let me write. So R square
minus 2R plus 1 equal to 0. The roots of the equation is R equal to 1, 1. Therefore, we can write the solution as some alpha, the roots are repeated here. So we can write the solution as alpha 1 plus alpha 2 into n. Into R power n. Yes, R is nothing but 1. So this 1 power n.
Okay. So we get alpha 1 and alpha 1 both are 1. So we get n plus 1. So this is very much similar to, the procedure will be exactly same as solving differential equation. So we have to find this. Can you please write the solution and share it in the WhatsApp group? In the workshop WhatsApp group is there, right? Please just solve this equation and put it in the workshop WhatsApp group. So others will also see how to solve this equation. Okay. Hello. Yeah. So who was saying about? Whoever said, please write it and share it in the group. Okay. Okay, so the final answer is n plus 1. Yeah. So we'll see one more problem quickly. Okay, this is simpler. So we do this problem. Such as the following matrices are non-singular. I plus A, where A not equal to 0, is a skew symmetric real n by n matrix. And every skew symmetric, question is which of the following matrices are non-singular. So every skew symmetric non-zero real 5x5 matrix, whether it is non-singular. Every skew symmetric non-zero 2x2 matrix. So is it non-singular? So among these three matrices, which of them are non-singular? Any idea how to do this?
Three matrices, three choices not true.
Okay.
Because the determinant of that odd skew symmetric matrix is zero. So it has only eigenvalue zero.
Determinant of odd
skew symmetric matrices of order is not zero.
Why? Why determinant of odd order?
Because it has a eigenvalue.
Why? Why it has eigenvalue 0? why it has eigenvalue 0? Any idea? So the main result is
transpose equal to when we take the determinant, determinant of A transpose equal to determinant of minus A. So it will become as determinant of A transpose nothing but A.
So taking okay, so A equal to minus A transpose. So what you are saying? A equal to minus A transpose, therefore?
Determinant of A equal to determinant of minus A transpose. It will be simply determinant of A.
Is equal to minus, minus 1 whole power A.
Determinant of A. Determinant of A transpose nothing but determinant of A.
Yeah, this is the.
This so is if it is odd.
Yeah. So if n is odd, we can
say that. So is the term of determinant of A equal 0. So determinant of A equal 0.
Yeah, correct. So this is a much simpler solution. So suppose you, so skew symmetric means that A equal to minus A transpose. That is what means skew symmetric. Symmetric means A equal to A transpose. Now we want to calculate the determinant of odd order skew symmetric matrix. So we so if A equal to minus A transpose, we apply determinant in both the sides. So determinant of A equal to determinant of minus A transpose. So if A is a n by n matrix, if you take a minus outside, it will come as minus 1 whole power n. If you take a scalar outside, it will come as c power n. Okay, so minus 1 whole power n times determinant of A transpose, but determinant of A equal to determinant of A transpose. So we get determinant of A equal to minus 1 whole power n determinant of A. If n is odd, then this will be minus. So determinant of A equal to minus of determinant of A. The only number which equal to its negative is 0. So we get determinant of A equal to 0. Okay, therefore they are saying that every skew symmetric non-zero real 5 by 5 matrix is non-singular. But actually we are getting singular. Actually it is always, see, to show some statement is false, it is enough to give one example. Okay, but if you consider any non-zero real 5 by 5 skew symmetric matrix, it is always singular. Okay, so this option is false. So what about A and C? So maybe we can again use the eigenvalue. So eigenvalue. So what can you say about eigenvalues of skew symmetric matrices?
Is either purely imaginary or zero.
Yeah, eigenvalues of skew symmetric matrices are either zero or purely imaginary. So that means that, so either it is zero or of the form some k, some alpha times I, alpha times y, where alpha belongs to R. So it will always lies in the imaginary axis. So that is what it means. So if you look at the eigenvalues of any skew symmetric matrix, it will always lie in the imaginary axis. Okay. Okay. So, but also what we know is complex roots occur. So that means that if Z belongs to C is a root of F of X belongs to R of X. If it is a root of a real polynomial, then Z bar complex conjugate is also a root of F of X. Okay, so from using this result, what we can do, we can conclude option C is true. Every skew symmetric non-zero 2 by 2 matrix. Huh? So So A is a 2 by 2 non-zero skew symmetry. Okay, then it is determinant is always not equal to 0 because eigenvalue of A equal to sum alpha I and minus alpha I. So eigenvalue should be of this form. Okay, because like there are only two eigenvalues. So if one eigenvalue is 0, then another eigenvalue also has to be 0. Okay, because one eigenvalue is 0, one eigenvalue alpha I, this is not possible, because if alpha I is a root, minus alpha I is also a root, so you will have three eigenvalues for a 2 by 2 matrix. That is not possible. Okay, so 0 cannot be an eigenvalue for a 2 by 2 non-zero skew symmetric matrix. So we conclude that determinant of A equal to alpha I into minus alpha I, this is equal to alpha square, which is so here in both here alpha not equal to 0. Okay, so this is not equal to 0. Therefore, if it is a 2 by 2 non-zero skew symmetric matrix, then it is determinant is not equal to 0. Similarly, if you look at the first problem, A not equal to 0 is a skew symmetric matrix. Again, skew symmetric matrix. Therefore, eigenvalues of A are either 0 or purely imaginary. Right? So, eigenvalues of I plus A are either 1 or, so either 1 or of the form 1 plus alpha I. Okay? So eigenvalues of I plus A are of the form 1 or 1 plus alpha I. But all these numbers are non-zero. So product of non-zero number is again non-zero. So we get determinant of I plus A is non-zero. Okay. Yeah. So this problem also think about it. It is this answer is also true. Okay.
Sir, in part 3, I have a doubt. Part C.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Sir, why can't the A has, you see, A is skew symmetric matrix, so it can have both eigenvalues 0.
It cannot have. Can it have?
It can have, because nilpotent matrices has all the eigenvalues 0.
No, they are not skew symmetric.
Nilpotent matrices can't be skew symmetric.
Yes.
From that, and then we can come.
Here they are given as a non-zero 2 by 2 matrix.
So non-zero 2 by 2 matrices can't have a...
Only zero matrix, zero nilpotent matrix on these.
What is the solid argument? The question now makes, what he's asking is correct, like why is skew symmetric matrix so both eigenvalues cannot be zero? That is a good question. Like, I didn't think of it. I just thought it is fine. So skew symmetric, both the eigenvalues are same. Eigenvalues are 0. Can we construct some example like that? Like, 2 by 2, you want both the eigenvalues are 0. This will be not work. What about the diagonal entry? So, diagonal entry should be 0, right? In a skew symmetric matrix.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So if it is a 2 by 2, then I think diagonal is 0, so this is some alpha, so this is minus alpha. So I think it is non-zero.
It's 0 is only 0 matrix. Other than non-zero matrix.
From that, we can. That
right. Yeah, if it's a 2x2 skew symmetric matrix, it is of this form. Because in a skew symmetric matrix, diagonal entries has to be zero because we have aij equal to minus aji. So in case of diagonal entry, we get aii equal to minus aii. So this is the definition of skew symmetric matrix. So if you put I equal to j, we get this condition. So this implies aii equal to zero for all i. So diagonal solve should be two. So this is half diagonal. So this should be like a non-zero. If it is alpha is zero, then it will be a zero matrix. Yeah. So from that we can conclude that. So determinant of this matrix will be like, what is it? Minus alpha square, which is not equal to zero. Or alpha square, right? Minus alpha square. So determinant is alpha square, which is not equal to zero. Anyway. So the third option is true. Anyway, it's good that you asked because I didn't think of it. I know it is true, but I didn't justify why 0,0 is not a root. It's not a possible eigenvalues. Okay. So any doubts except this? If you have some doubts, please ask. Meanwhile, I'll think why determinant of A is not equal to 0 if and only rank of A equal to n. How to prove this simple result without using any result? So any other doubts?
Not. I think no, there is no doubt from audience side.
Okay. So maybe this determinant of A is not equal to 0 if and only rank of A equal to n without using Rankine theorem. That will be some good problem to check in some books. Like I don't see any immediate answer. So by using some result only, I think we have the solution. Yeah.
Okay.
So we'll discuss it over there in the group for WhatsApp. Yeah.
Okay. Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you so much.